make sure that I go as fast as possible because earlier today I was talking so much that I didn't get a chance to get everybody's questions in, so I make sure I get everybody's questions in this session. But just quickly, I also didn't give you guys a history earlier on myself. I want to run you through basically how hip-hop developed and how technology played a part in that, because most of what we do is based off of technology. So very quickly, I was born in 1974. I know I look like I'm like 18, but I'm actually 39. And at that time, there was no hip-hop music. My cousins and people that I used to just follow and look up to were very into disco and funk records. So around 1979, 1980, I can remember my cousins coming down from New Jersey with these cassette tapes that they used to record in the park. And they used to call these, like, they used to come and say, hey, we have a park jam. Two of the same records, so that now that part, this is over, I can play it again. pressure because they have got to afford some people with this new thing that the guys are doing uptown in the Bronx. So they go to a pizza shop and get three guys that work in this pizza shop. One of them think that can't. So they go to them and say, hey, can you guys do this? Can you do this hip hop? We want to record. So I said, okay, we don't really know how to do this. We don't really know what it is. So Big Bang Hank happened to know Grandmaster Cass. So he goes to Cass and he says, hey, can you write me a line? These guys want to record me. Right? So Grandmaster Cass says, hey, I can care less. Throw in the book and says, take whatever rhyme you want out of that. Right? And this guy chooses a rhyme that says to the hip hop, hip hop, you don't stop the rock. And it becomes the biggest hip hop record ever. As a matter of fact, in that record, Big Bang Hank says, I'm casting on the fly. Like he's actually rhyming as if he's Cass. It's the weirdest thing, because no one respected what we were doing at the given time. This is the birth of our culture. This is where it comes from. We move on from this to these guys actually recording records. Now, when this was first happening, hip hop was being done with bands, right? The Sugar Hill Gang actually recorded the first couple of songs with an actual band. So when they put these records out, the hip hop community heard these records and were like, this is not what we do. This is, I have no idea what this is. This is not what you guys are doing in the park. And they rejected it. It was one big hit, but after that, people were like, okay, well, what is this? So we had another genius by the name of Rick Rubin, who was heavy on the rock scene. And he was the guy who basically stripped down hip hop to basic drum machines and had you guys scratch rock and roll riffs over these drum beats, right? He hooks up with this guy. Now, Rick Rubin was a musician. He was a guy that was concerned with making records, right? He's going to NYU at the time, also going to NYU at this time, is another guy that happens to be the brother of Run-DMC, right? So he decides to stick Run-DMC with Rick Rubin, and this is how we get monumental group Run-DMC and the first song, Rock Box, which was the very first hip-hop song ever to reach MTV, right? Which is a milestone, which is a big thing for us. So boom, hip-hop hits the scene, starts to blow up. You see this thing is a real genre, and goes worldwide. So then we get to a point where certain people start to understand that there were certain records that you could watch when you were in the parks playing that people would go crazy for, right? Whenever you played a Jim Brown record, everybody went crazy, right? Whenever you played certain breakbeats, everybody would go crazy. And we would use these particular songs to now produce our records. The thing about Afro Bambaataa is that he had the intelligence to play any record. It wasn't a genre that was made off of one thing. We took music from all genres. So inside of the Universal Zulu Nation party, you might hear a rock and roll song, you might hear the drums from the Monkees, you might hear a jazz song. It doesn't matter, as long as the groove was there, that's all that we were concerned about, was the groove. So when we start to make these records, we actually went in and a DJ would sit there and do exactly what he did in the park for 5 minutes. He would extend that breaking for 5 minutes and we'd record that on maybe two tracks of a reel. And then he put on another record and he'd play that reel back and he'd scratch a guitar riff all the way down for 5 minutes, right? And we'd continue this process layer and layer and layer until we got to a final product. As technology starts to get better, we start to use what we call now samplers, right? But the way that these samplers were created was not really the way that we were supposed to use them. One of the biggest things was that Roger Lynn, who has probably done more for our culture than anyone else, and not knowing that he did, in the conversation that I had with him, he said that he had no idea that he would basically give some kids a culture. But what Roger Lynn did was create drum machines. He was a guitar player who wanted to sell his music, so he created the LM1. And the LM1 had pre-programmed drum sounds in it, but you could make your own patterns, which was incredible for him, right? It gives us the Stevie Wonder, it gives us the Prince, it gives us the Sly. All these people start making incredible records with this drum machine. Then he had a great idea to say, well, what if I can allow my user to insert their own sounds, their own drums? And that's really what his idea was to allow people to say, okay, if you don't want to use my stock sounds, put your own drum sounds in there. And for a minute, that's what we did. missing record that starts to develop from the breakbeats that we were using. But at this time, we were looping up maybe, you know, 5 seconds of a whole breakbeat inside of this drum sample. These samplers were very old and very, we maybe had like 9 seconds. The original SP-1200 had 12 seconds of sampling time. So we had to make an entire record with just 12 seconds, right? We would do things like put the record on 45, you know, speed it up so that once we can get enough information and slow it down back to its original pitch. Or I used to cheat even further and just completely turn the turntable off and just spin the turntable as fast as I could to get as much information in there and then slow it back down, right? That was my little cheating method. Another guy who lived in Queens by the name of Molly Mall discovered one day while he was trying to put a snare into something else that he could sample particular snares and drums and kicks off of other records like the James Brown record. This totally revolutionized what we were doing. Because now I have individual drum parts from, let's say, Peace the President, which is a popular breakbeat that we use in hip hop, and now I can do my own pattern, right? As you've seen over the years how technology helps us develop and to start to move forward in the making of our music. So we move from 1983, when Run-DMC comes on the scene, and 1986, this phenomenal album comes out called Critical Beatdown, which is by the Ultramania MCs. It basically introduced us to all the classic hip hop samples, right? So one album has so many of the classic hip hop samples on it and taught people how to build what we thought was collage music. We were taking from different sources because these people were musicians, but they never went to school to study any type of music. But somehow, miraculously, I guess this is just human ear and the way they hear, they would pull from 6, 7 different sources, and all of them being human, and all of them being time. Right? The guy who said Gene was one of the biggest producers for that album. He also leaves that album and goes and makes another album with this guy called KRS-One. Criminal Minded, which becomes a huge, huge hit record. All these things are showing us different styles and different forms and ways that we can create a new music, right? So then we moved to 1989, and we get introduced to this group called Bomb Squad, which totally, totally threw hip-hop on its ear, because not only were these guys sampling music, but they were sampling anything, noise, dissonant sounds that weren't in any key. Just anything that was aggressive that added to the flavor of what their group was trying to do, right? At this time, there was a company named Makai that came out with a beat machine called the MPC-60. This completely changed everything, because now the SP-1200, like I said, only have 12 seconds worth of sampling time. Now Roger Lynn moves to Makai and makes the MPC-60, and changes the format. He makes the pads 4 rows of 4 instead of the SP-1200 that only had 8 pads. This allowed us to add way more samples and be way more creative. When he updated the MPC-60, he made the MPC-62. Now we have stereo sampling, which is like, okay, this is a whole other world. Now I can choose which side of the record that I want to deal with, or I can deal with the stereo sample and create a stereo image. Public Enemy's albums were incredibly important to the hip hop culture just for the technique of what they were doing and how they layered so many samples. Once this MPC-60 and MPC-62 hit, we start to see the music move from just an East Coast thing. Now, all this was going on in a very small area. This was just New York City and maybe little parts of New Jersey. It hadn't really moved to anywhere else yet. By this time now, we start to see the music move to the West Coast. And we see groups like NWA start to develop. And they start to give us different styles than what we've heard on the East Coast, because now we have what's considered the I Do Nothing of it, but we have the gang culture actually coming into hip hop. We have young guys that are representing their neighborhood and showing how they live every day and scare the heck out of America, right? What is this? Who are these guys? What are they doing? But all this is based off the technology. As the technology grows, what we do grows. So we move from the MPC-60 and the MPC-62 to now what I consider the classic, which is an MPC-3000. So now we have stereo sampling, now we have 16-bit 44 sampling before we bit sample. There was a lot greater sound, but as we moved to a 16-bit sampler, now we're starting to get some clarity and some variation into what we can do. And we start to move into a time where nothing is off limits, right? Everything is available for us to sample. And we start to get the most creative music that we've ever heard outside of hip hop, or in hip hop, should I say, until we get to this guy by the name of Biz Markie. Now, Biz Markie was part of the Marty Mauls crew, and he had already put out one album. The album did great for him. It's called Nobody Beats Biz. Biz Markie, Marty Mauls. A lot of these were his phenomenal hits. He goes to make a second record, and he samples this song, I think it was O'Sullivan, for a song called Spring Again. And O'Sullivan's son, I believe, heard the record and told his dad, said, "Hey, Dad, this guy's using your song. And, you know, he didn't pay you for it." So we start to move into a space where this is the first time where anyone's ever challenged the fact that people are using other people's music to make records. So we have our first lawsuit in hip hop, right? This was such a monumental thing because now we have to write a law that deals with sampling and that deals with the usage of someone else's music in your composition. Biz Markie actually lost that case, and his albums were stripped off of the shelf. He actually removed it. That was the court order. So now we enter into a time where we have rules as to what we can do and can't do inside of hip hop in terms of how we make our music. It's totally changed everything. So now with sample claims, we start to see hip hopers say, "Okay, I need to learn how to play music because I'm not going to keep paying these guys to use their music." Sampling still continued, but it was something that forced hip hop, and I think it was great, to actually learn music. So we start to see more West Coast music develop where the producers are actually playing on these albums and actually incorporating a lot of musicians, which brings in what we call like the G-Funk era, where these guys were emulating what they heard on Paul and Frank Doug albums, or High Clear albums, things of that nature, and brought a completely new sound to hip hop. And as we keep moving, we run into an era where we get into a complete positive era, right? This is the Tribe Called Quest era. This is a group that we call the Native Tones, which was comprised of about five or six different groups that were a complete conglomerate of people. They started to incorporate a machine that Kai made called the S950, which was a rack mount version, supposedly, of the MPC-60, but had way more sample time and had abilities to do things that the MPC-60 didn't do. Now, for the first time, we can change the sample rate on samplers. That was a huge, huge thing. It gave us a lot of clarity, but it also gave us the ability to go back to a grindier sound of what we were doing. Right? And then we moved into an era where most hip hoppers that were making music were emulating something else that they were seeing, or they were trying to make a sound that sounded like something else that they had already seen. We started to move into an era where creativity and being completely different was now the new king. So this moves us into so many different areas of music. Hip hoppers would sample from reggae music. Sample from funk music, jazz music. You could imagine what the palette becomes of music. The normal case would be for me to wake up in the morning and to go to a record store and to just listen to music for 8 hours, to try to find some riff, some drum track, some bass line, something that I could throw together. And again, this is me pulling from so many different sources and trying to match keys and match tempos and also make some unique feel out of someone else's music, right? This is the basis of what we do in hip hop. This is the basis of how we construct records or the way that we want to express ourselves